in people generally. I think another round of applause for him would be quite appropriate. Thank you. The second presenter in this NCU-sponsored section is Dr. Karen Phillips. Dr. Karen Phillips is an internal medicine specialist. She's a graduate of the University of the West Indies at Mona. And for the past 14 years, has been working as a physician specializing in diabetes and endocrinology. She operates the Revamp Comprehensive Rehabilitation Center that assists patients with rehabilitative care. Her topic today is diabetes, alcohol, and the heart. She's a consultant physician at the KPH, associate lecturer and honorary consultant at the UWI, and in her spare time, when she finds it, she likes to read, practice yoga, and the Pilates. Please help me welcome Dr. Karen Phillips as our second presenter.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. This afternoon, I'll be reviewing what I think is a very interesting and maybe a little bit controversial topic. I'll be really reviewing the role of alcohol on cardiovascular disease in type 2 diabetes. And by the end of this presentation, you can answer that question. Is it always a bad mix? So I'll be mentioning a little bit about the pathophysiology of coronary artery disease. I'll be looking at some risk factors for coronary artery disease. I'll be spending a little bit more time on alcohol and coronary artery disease, and especially in the diabetic patient, and make some concluding statements. Sorry about that. So Professor Reese already gave us an idea of the scope of the problem. We all know that type 2 diabetes is a growing problem. It's a serious progressive disease which is characterized by insulin resistance and beta cell dysfunction. It accounts for about 90% of diabetes cases worldwide and is associated with significant micro and macrovascular complications which represent a significant disease and economic burden. I'm not getting this, sorry. So it clearly is not a mild disease. Eight out of every 10 diabetic patients will die from a cardiovascular event. And you can see the scope of the other complications on this slide. Here, this is another representation of the risk in both males and females with type 2 diabetes in terms of cardiovascular disease and other heart disease compared to patients who don't have diabetes. Okay. Germane to the pathophysiology of coronary heart disease are factors that promote plaque formation, instability, and rupture, and factors that initiate and control the progression of thrombus after rupture. Here we see a representation of a clot in the endothelium, which has ruptured, and we can see the interplay of prothrombotic and opposing agents in terms of thrombosis. So here, with a plasminogen activator inhibitor, fibrinogen, urokinase type plasminogen activator, to mention a few. So this is an idea of what it looks like. And here we are looking at another picture of what the plaque looks like in the vessel itself. And more than 50% of that plaque is actually due to cholesterol. So, what are risk factors for coronary artery disease? We are well aware of the non-modifiable risk factors, including age. Of course, we are well aware that with increasing age, there's definitely an increased risk of coronary artery disease. In terms of sex, throughout all age groups, we know that males tend to have a higher prevalence of coronary artery disease than women. And of course, heredity plays an important role, not only family history, but ethnicity. So African Americans, Pacific Islanders, and Hawaiians, to mention a few, populations at risk of diabetes and hypertension are at increased risk of coronary artery disease. We're well aware of our modifiable risk factors, smoking, dyslipidemia, hypertension, diabetes, which we're concerned today, obesity, and physical inactivity. And then there are other risk factors which may not be so well established, such as homocysteine, which has not really been validated or verified in studies, and inflammatory CRP. Then we're looking at our contributing risk factors, such as stress, which may act through negative lifestyle behaviors and excess alcohol consumption. Now, there are a number of epidemiological studies which have been done, which have shown that the risk of heart disease in people who drink moderate amounts of alcohol, which on average is one drink per day for women or two drinks per day for men, is lower than in non-drinkers. And of course, one drink is defined as 1.5 fluid ounces of 80 proof spirits, or one fluid ounce of 100 proof spirits, four fluid ounces of wine, or 12 fluid ounces of beer. So what of alcohol and heart disease? There are a lot of studies have looked at this, but these are all epidemiological studies. And generally, there is an inverse relationship between alcohol consumption and heart disease. And we're talking about coronary artery disease here. Okay, so we're going to look a little bit more now at alcohol and the heart in terms of cardiovascular disease. Clearly, this is an area which is still not well understood, despite the multitude of studies which have looked at it. And the French paradox is quite interesting, because this speaks to the fact that it was observed in the French many, many years ago that this population, they had a lesser incidence of coronary artery disease compared to other industrialized nations. And it was thought that this was due to their heavy consumption of red wine, which led to a whole review of red wine itself and whether the role of antioxidants in red wine may play a role in cardioprotectiveness, etc. And clearly a very controversial area in medicine. But irrespective of whether red wine or other liquors are cardioprotective, we do know that the abundance of evidence is suggesting that there is a beneficial influence on coronary artery disease with moderate alcohol consumption. So just some fast facts about alcohol. Moderate drinking is defined as no more than one drink per day for women and less than two drinks per day for men. We should always recognize that patients will tend to underestimate how much they drink. Binge drinking is referred to as more than four drinks on a single occasion for men and more than three drinks per day for women. And one drink is referred to as about 15 grams of alcohol, maybe anywhere around 10 to 15 grams in the studies that have looked at this. Now, looking at some standard alcoholic drinks, I'm not sure if that is projecting too well, but in terms of a 12-ounce can of beer, the alcohol content is about 5%, 5 ounces of table wine, about 12%, 3 to 4 ounces of sherry or port, about 17%, and 1.5 ounces of a shot of 80-proof distilled spirits, such as gin, rum, vodka, whiskey, or brandy, 40% alcohol content. Okay, so how does alcohol exert this beneficial effect? As I said before, there are a number of epidemiological studies which have noticed the association. And Rimetal looked at a wide number of these studies, maybe over 40 of these studies, and in this meta-analysis, and came up with some conclusions. He noted that the effect of alcohol consumption on the risk of coronary heart disease is attributed to mainly increasing HDL, which confers about a 60% benefit, fibrinogen at about 20 to 30%, insulin resistance or improvement in insulin resistance at about 5 to 10%, and other hemostatic factors such as plasminogen activator inhibitor, about 0 to 5%. Let's look closer on the role of HDL in protection. But how does HDL work? How does alcohol increase HDL levels? It's not quite sure. There are a number of postulates. It may be a direct effect on the liver. It could be increasing hepatic production and secretion of apolipoprotein and lipoprotein particles. Or is it increasing triglyceride lipases and decreased removal of circulatory HDL? We're not sure. The studies have not answered that because we're not been able to look at clinical trials. However, we do know that the effect occurs after 1 to 2 weeks of daily consumption, and it remains unless the consumption is decreased. There has been no appreciable difference noted with beverage type, and there is a linear relationship between alcohol and increase in HDL beyond the range of moderate consumption, so that is very interesting. 30 grams of alcohol per day would actually increase your HDL by about 0.1 millimole per liter, or 4 milligrams per deciliter. The impact is actually greater among subjects with baseline HDL levels less than 1 millimole per liter, and a 0.1 millimole per liter increase in HDL would be associated with a 17% reduction in risk of coronary heart disease, and this is what has been shown, which is quite significant. In terms of fibrinogen, he again noted that fibrinogen accounts for about 20 to 30% of the coronary heart disease benefit attributed to moderate consumption. So approximately 30 grams per day of alcohol would decrease fibrinogen by an estimated 7.5 milligrams per 100 mils. That is a 12.5% decrease in coronary heart disease risk, making it the second biggest contributor to reduction in cardiovascular risk associated with alcohol consumption. Of course, the overall contribution of other hemostatic factors was actually less than 5%. The studies also looked at lipoprotein A and triglyceride levels, but there were limited studies with respect to these, and there was no consistent relationship between alcohol and lipoprotein A levels found. There's a relatively weak but consistent positive association between alcohol and triglyceride concentration, which you would imagine would attenuate the benefit of alcohol on the risk of coronary heart disease. However, it was noted that about 20 grams per day of alcohol would increase triglyceride by about 0.06 millimoles per liter, resulting in a 1.9% increased risk of coronary heart disease. But of course, this is negligible compared to the effects on HDL levels, which if you remember is 27% or 17%. In terms of hemostatic and other factors, Mead et al. In 1979 noticed a positive association between alcohol consumption and fibrinolytic activity, and noted that alcohol not only affects fibrinogen levels, but plasminogen activators and plasminogen inhibitors, which play a role in thrombus progression or retainment. There are other effects of alcohol which are also important. As I mentioned before, there is the role of increased insulin sensitivity, which is contributing about a 5 to 10% benefit on coronary heart disease risk. And there have been a number of studies which have looked at that. And in fact, these studies would even suggest in some of the series that were looked at that alcohol in moderate amounts can even delay the onset of type 2 diabetes or controversial, but may actually improve glycemia. Alcohol may also affect the autonomic control, adrenergic signaling, and signal transduction in the myocardium, and these are all thought to be beneficial in terms of preventing or lowering cardiovascular risk. In terms of genetics, the role of genetics, genes or your genetics or your genetic makeup may modify the effect of alcohol consumption on your cardiovascular risk. And in fact, different alleles of alcohol dehydrogenase enzyme may affect alcohol metabolism and the risk of heart disease. So this might be particularly prevalent in particular populations. Drinking pattern is also important. It is thought that regularity of consumption and accompaniment of food can alter certain cardiovascular markers. And it's important to know that sporadic heavy drinking may increase cardiovascular and stroke risk. And this table just serves to summarize what I've just said. Metabolic capacity, looking at gender, genetics, and body size, genetic modifiers, such as genetic differences in cardiovascular genes, The role of increased HDL, decreased fibrinogen, and increased insulin sensitivity, plus other hemostatic factors conferring a benefit on coronary artery disease. Okay, so let's look now in particular at alcohol and cardiovascular disease in the diabetic patient, quite controversial area. There are only a few studies available to make it any worse. And in fact, none of the studies available have actually differentiated between wine, beer, or other alcoholic beverage. As I said, all the studies and the studies which contribute to this body of evidence are all epidemiological studies, which basically, you know, does not necessarily translate into the clinical setting. So no prospective randomized clinical trial has been really done to look at this. Okay, what is happening? You know, in terms of our local data, there's always a paucity of local data. I was able to find from Ferguson et al., a study done, small study done out of the ERU, looking at, the study actually looked at the role of alcohol on cardiovascular risk factors and mental health in a cohort of our diabetic patients at the University Diabetes Clinic. The total cohort was about 118 patients, the mean age 55.4 years, the majority of them being females, which represents the geography of that clinic. This was a cross-sectional study, and the mean duration of diabetes in the patients was 16.1 years. Only 7.4% of these patients admitted to be current drinkers. In terms of the results, I was only able to get the information on increased total cholesterol levels and increased triglyceride levels as cardiovascular risk markers. And these were not thought to be significant in terms of the drinkers and the non-drinkers. Of course, there are a number of limitations to this study, the small sample size, the self-reporting of alcohol consumption, which could possibly, you know, underreport patients. Could possibly underreport, especially in this setting. In terms of internationally, there are maybe about three main studies which have looked at this. The Nurses' Health Study included nurses in the United States over 30 years of age, middle-aged nurses, over 39,000 patient years of follow-up over a 14-year period, and 295 cardiovascular events were documented over this period, 194 cases of non-fatal MI and 101 cases of fatal MI. The relative risk for fatal or non-fatal cardiovascular disease among the diabetic females who reported a usual intake of less than 5 grams per day, which is much less than one drink per day, was 0.74, whereas the relative risk for those reporting an intake of more than 5 grams per day, more approaching like half a drink a day, was actually significantly less, almost halved at 0.48. They basically concluded from this that approximately one drink per day, half the risk of coronary heart disease among nurses with type 2 diabetes compared with non-drinking nurses. Clearly, you can imagine that this can't be generalized. They're looking mainly at middle-aged females, nurses. The fact that it was a homogenous group is actually good, but it can't be generalized to the entire body of diabetic people. The Physicians' Health Study looked at a large number of United States physicians. This study was actually a prospective randomized study which actually sought to examine the effects of aspirin at 325 milligrams daily and beta carotene at 50 milligrams every other day on the development of cardiovascular disease and cancer. And basically they sought to invite these patients to partake in a questionnaire which looked at their alcohol levels of alcohol consumption. So over 87,000 participants, over 87,000 physicians participated, and over 2,700 of them were diabetic. At baseline, they were free of myocardial infarction, cancer, stroke, and liver disease, and they were followed for 5.5 years. So during over 480,000 person years of follow-up, 717 deaths occurred in the non-diabetics and 133 among the diabetics. Now, The relative risk for coronary deaths in the drinkers compared with the non-drinkers was 1.11 for monthly consumers, 0.67 for weekly consumers, and 0.42 for daily consumers. Again, we are seeing the evidence for a lower risk of coronary deaths or events with increasing alcohol consumption up to 1 day, and the reduction was similar for both diabetics and non-diabetics. They concluded that light to moderate alcohol consumption is associated with a similar reduction in risk of coronary artery disease in diabetic males as among men in the general population. Again, this study can't be generalized to females, but then we have the nurses' health study speaking to the females. It can't be generalized to older diabetics because it was mainly middle-aged males. But what was good about this study is that it was a very large study and it was a very homogeneous group. They were all of the similar socioeconomic status, had the same access to healthcare, similar educational background. So they also controlled for underlying illnesses, because there's a suggestion that some people might argue that the patients who, or the participants who were not actually, or maybe I should say this another way, that the fact that some people are not current drinkers might be related to the fact that they have comorbidities. So you might not want to drink if you've had a diagnosis of a heart attack or if you've had a diagnosis of cancer. So this might actually color the results that you might get. So that is why they actually controlled for these factors. And despite this, there was the evidence to suggest that there was this beneficial effect. Val Madrid et al. Looked at older diabetics, mean age of 68 years, and over 12.3 years of follow-up. And he controlled for multiple other risk factors as well. He found that basically, or they found, the group found that former drinkers, their relative risk of coronary death was 0.69. For current drinkers of less than 2 grams per day, 0.54. For current drinkers more than 2 to 13 grams per day, that's less than a drink per day, 0.44. And for current drinkers more than 14 grams or about 1 drink per day, 0.21. So again, we have the trend, which is in favor of the overall beneficial effect of alcohol consumption in decreasing the risk of death due to coronary artery disease. And this is for older patients. Now, there are two other smaller studies which were looked at. The multinational study of vascular disease in diabetes, I think this was endorsed by the WHO, and it showed that alcohol intake was associated with decreased death from ischemic heart disease in men with type 2 diabetes. The Wisconsin epidemiological study of diabetic retinopathy also showed that 55 to 75% reduction in risk of death occurred was caused by coronary artery disease in people with older onset diabetes who consumed more than one drink per day. Okay, so we have a bit of evidence. However, we need to bear in mind that there are other effects of alcohol in the diabetic patients. So in terms of what we tell our patients, how or how this would want to influence our practice, we need to bear in mind that for diabetic patients consuming alcohol, there's an increased risk of hypoglycemia in the fasting state as well as in combination with their anti-diabetic medications, whether tablets or insulin. So we need to be aware of that. Weight gain is usually a problem in this population where insulin resistance is a big part of the challenge. And so we know that alcohol is referred to as basically empty calories. One can of beer will increase, will give you about 100 calories. So we need to be aware of that. And it's been well established that there is a worsening microvascular complications, a worsening of retinopathy and worsening of neuropathy in diabetics who consume alcohol. And of course, the increased risk of elevated blood pressure readings. We also need to consider that even small amounts of alcohol in the elderly may impair judgment, coordination, and reaction time. And of course, there is a number of drug interactions which may occur with the use of alcohol in this population, a population which is largely on a number of other medications because of their other health challenges or comorbidities. So, what do we take home from this? There's a big public health perspective to this. Certainly, you would be aware that promoting moderate alcohol consumption would lead to abuse in certain at-risk individuals, so we need to be cautious. However, in countries where coronary artery disease is the leading cause of mortality, the benefit of moderate consumption has been actually incorporated into guidelines, for example, in the US. So policies and legislation on consumption will vary widely across countries. However, we should demonstrate caution in framing guidelines for alcohol in view of the relatively insufficient data. And as I said before, the data is mainly from epidemiological studies. And any guidelines should be kept in the larger context of diet and exercise. And I will end by quoting, there recently was a forum, a big forum on alcohol, on the effects on heart disease, and Eric Stockenberg, I think his name was, he had to say that the public health messages should acknowledge the reduced risk of incidence and mortality of coronary heart disease associated with moderate drinking. However, we should not expect official recommendations in light of drinking on a par with exercise, vegetables, and not smoking. The caveats would be too many, and official recommendations should be based on prospective randomized studies. The role of alcohol drinking is best discussed in the scenario of a patient taking medical advice from his personal physician. And to conclude, his colleague, Professor Robert Klatsky, basically, he thought that the risks of moderate drinking differ by sex, age, personal history, and family history. And as is often the case in medical practice, advice about lifestyle must be based on something less than certainty. So there is no substitute for balanced judgment by a knowledgeable, objective health professional. So what is required is a synthesis of common sense and the best available scientific facts. So I'll end here. Thank you.
You can imagine how this would appear were there any journalists in here. Northern Caribbean University advocates moderate alcohol consumption. But the dialogue is wide open, and we would like to thank Dr. Phillips for enlightening us with some research findings. I think another round of applause for her. And for both our presenters, all I would say is that we have been delighted to have them, and that Northern Caribbean University has been happy and delighted to be associated with this conference and to have been sponsors of this section. Thank you very much. I'm terribly sorry. Are there some questions? Yes. Yes, go ahead.
Good evening.
Yes, go ahead.
Right. My first question is to Professor Rees. You looked at the analogs, non-insulin drug treatment, therapy, and you look at the Lispro as well as the Aspart. I would like to know what are the effects that these drugs have on the liver, if any.
Well, both the Lispro and the Aspart are basically insulin, and to my knowledge, I've not seen any metabolic studies looking at liver metabolism with either or both of them. So I would expect the same type of effect on both Lispro and Aspart as you would have in insulin itself.
Okay.
But I've not seen that, so I can't really give you any definitive answer. I'm giving you what I would suspect, but I'm not seeing these specifically studied in that manner.
Okay, all right. Thank you very much. Dr. Phillips, in your presentation, you mentioned clearly that moderate consumption of alcohol reduces the fibrinogen levels. I am wondering what implication does that have on patients who are anticoagulated? And even further, what implication does it have on patients who are anticoagulated patients who themselves become accident victims? In one instance, we look at the fact that it reduces the risk of thrombosis in cardiovascular diseases. But what considerations are there for hemorrhaging?
Okay, thank you for the question. As you can imagine, as I said before, there are certain populations that you definitely would be careful in terms of advocating moderate alcohol use. And maybe somebody who is being anticoagulated need not be on alcohol. Well, should not be drinking alcohol. So.
All right. Next microphone, go ahead. Is there a question? Oh, it's not a question. Okay. There being no further questions. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.